Welcome to our 27th annual Alzheimer's Day. On behalf of the entire Mesulam Center, we want to thank you guys for being a part of our panel today. Can you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Well, my name is Russell Zage, and I have been diagnosed with FTD for 2 years now, I believe it is, and working through all of the issues with that.
And I'm his wife, Barbara. It's an interesting journey to be on this. We're trying to cope as best we can.
Can you tell us how you guys both first heard about FTD?
I'd never heard of FTD. And when it became a suspected diagnosis, he told us all about it. And as he was explaining what it was and what was happening, I was sitting there saying, yes, yes, that's how things are.
After you started noticing, you know, those things that seemed a little bit off, can you tell us more about what that diagnostic process was like?
We had seen his family doctor. Russ was referred to a therapist because they thought it was depression. So that was a lengthy course of therapy that I could see was not helping him in any way. And then it was back to the doctor again, and this time a referral to a neurologist who suspected depression and wanted to engage in therapy again. When we met he was a geriatric psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. And upon telling him some of the symptoms that was going on, that's when he said, I believe these are all symptoms of FTD.
How have you guys maintained connection with each other, you know, and with your other friends and family in your life during this time as well?
I don't have that partner in the way that I used to have a partner.
Absolutely.
And family has been struggling with the diagnosis, and I've had to deal with a lot of that, trying to bring it together. Yeah. And come with some acceptance.
We do have a very close couple that we do things with, and you know, they had no problems being together with us or us being with them or trying to do things. And I think that gave a little bit of a sense of sanity to the whole situation. One of the other things too is that many of the things that Barb sees, I don't necessarily always recognize either. Okay. And I think that makes it difficult when she's trying to tell me something and I don't really see it.
So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about some of your experiences with the Mesulam Center. You guys have been participating in our research here and wanted to hear from your perspective some of those highlights and what that experience has been like for you both.
It has been very, very helpful, very supportive. You are dealing with a group of individuals, you know, from at every level in healthcare. Mm-hmm. That understand the disease. Having been through the process of people not even knowing about FTD, let alone diagnosing it, but having no idea what it is and being misdiagnosed, to get into a facility where they understand and they care and they offer you support in every way possible is such a positive.
I think for me, it's been being treated like a person and not a disease has helped with that, because when I think of some of the testing and things that you do, and you're very familiar with it, Abby, but some of the memory tests and things like that, in some ways, when I was down there the first couple of times, I almost felt like those were insulting, because some of those are simple to do.
Right.
And yet I understand where that's coming from, but the people that were working with me doing all of that always made me feel very comfortable that it was okay to do that. And you know, it was okay if I did well on something. It was okay if I didn't do well on something, but they didn't make me feel like I was less of a person or that the person part of me was not important, that they were just looking at to find out what discrepancies I had from things that were going on. And that was very helpful to me.
Oh, it's so wonderful to hear. You know, I've been fortunate to have the opportunity to work with you guys on some of our research. So I can't tell you how heartwarming it is to hear that your experience overall has been so positive with Northwestern. It just, it means the world. It really does.
The other thing about the Mesulam Center is the research. And I'm so proud of Russ for wanting to participate. And you see so many younger people struggling with that diagnosis. I think the blessing out of that is that you are doing the research, and through that, I think a lot of issues will be resolved for people.
Wanted to ask what advice you guys would give to someone who has been recently diagnosed with FTD and to their caregivers or family members during that time as well.
Work towards an understanding of as much of it as you can. I did not do that. And it took time for me to kind of get on board with that and to, you know, as Barb says, sometimes I still don't even want to admit that it's there because I feel like I'm functioning and things. And to have somebody close like Barb is that can be monitoring my symptoms and knowing what's going on, it gives me a different perspective sometimes. She sees things differently than I might see them. And I think that's been helpful.
Accepting or trying to acknowledge that your life is ever changing at this point. And it could change every day. It could change every week. It could change every moment.
What would you guys say supports you both in living your very best life?
It's the support and the people at the Mesulam Center, because having someone understand what you're dealing with and what you're going through is such a huge support. And the fact that so much of healthcare, so many healthcare professionals have never even heard of FTD. So you know, it's like trying to climb up the hill of sand. You just keep going down, 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 because no one's understanding what you're saying, you know, and when you live with someone for 40 years, you recognize the changes.
Being associated with the people at the center that do understand that is extremely helpful. The prime example she was talking about, my internal medicine physician, great person, great doctor. I've known him for probably 35 years, worked with him, but he sometimes looks at me and says, well, how can you still teach classes? How can you know, their concept of dementia is very one-sided to dementia. It means that you are no longer capable of doing anything. And I struggle with the fact that I still am very capable of doing a lot of things.
We're so thankful that you've found support amongst us here. It's an honor to be able to offer that. So thank you guys.
We thank you too.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. Could you please start by introducing yourselves and giving us a little bit of background information on how your lives have been touched by Alzheimer's disease?
Hi, I'm Candace. I'm the oldest of the siblings. Our mother has early cognitive decline, but we think it's Alzheimer's disease. She lives with my father in the suburbs of Chicago, and my siblings and I live in this city.
I'm Celine.
I'm Chris.
Can you guys start by just telling us how you first heard about Alzheimer's disease?
Her mom was diagnosed with mild cognitive impairment about 5 years ago, and we think it's full-blown Alzheimer's right now, early onset. She's only 66. And so we've been caring for her. We've been trying to adjust our lives to accommodate her life. And we've just been dealing with it as a family as best as possible.
What led your mother to seek a diagnostic evaluation initially?
I think a couple of things led to us realizing that something was wrong. She is a pediatrician, and so we heard that she was repeating her history and physicals with patients, not remembering to call in prescriptions, not remembering she had already seen them, just making little mistakes. And so she was very sharp, acute, and very functional. And so when we heard she was making these mistakes in her practice, we started to get concerned for her career. But also I noticed kind of around the same time that when I would call her, she would forget some of the things we talked about. For example, I would call her on my way home from work and I would tell her where I was working. And then she would repeat herself, ask me again, where was I working? Was I on my way to work? Was I going home from work? And so she couldn't remember the little details that she normally could before this all happened. And it was just a slow, gradual decline that we noticed. There were these little things that she just wouldn't remember. And initially, I remember getting very upset on the phone and saying to her, I just told you that. Wow, how can you not remember it?
How have you guys all individually and then with your mother dealt with the challenges that this last year has brought upon everybody?
We tried to plan some kind of family gathering almost every week. So we all live in the city of Chicago and our parents are out in the suburbs. But then obviously with COVID, that all had to stop. The fact that we weren't able to see her anymore was pretty hard to deal with because we were making that extra effort to get together for her sake, you know, right. So she saw us on a consistent basis. She could still remember us. And we know that being with us, her children, is one of the things that makes her the most happy.
I do remember struggling with being a first-time mom. And I realized like how many memories she was going to miss out with my son, her grandson. And I remember being very sad, you know, these are the things that she wanted. She just wanted to have memories with her grandson / grandkids. So we had to adjust and, you know, we do FaceTime and we did Zoom and Google Hangouts for holidays. I remember also there was a time in the beginning that I was trying to tell my parents to not go. I was very, very cautious and told them not to go out to the grocery, but I would bring them groceries and drop them off the driveway. And it was very difficult because you can't tell someone with dementia to socially distance.
Right.
So I would get out of the car, drop off the groceries, with, you know, say hi, but you know, my mom would obviously want a hug. And it's, you know, obviously very difficult not to hug my mom, but also difficult to hug her just in case like I would get her sick.
Like you came up with some different creative strategies on how you stayed connected and able to keep communicating with her throughout this time. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that, on what that was like, particularly because she does have the cognitive impairment that she's dealing with and how you guys really helped form and hang on to that bond over this period of time?
When my mom was first diagnosed, back in 2016, mm-hmm. even pre-COVID, it did make us closer as a family because we realized that, you know, my mom physically was there, but mentally declining. So we were all on the same team. We wanted to do what was best for her. So we put aside everything else just to try to be the best family that we could and be there for each other.
We really tried to remain as close as possible, especially with us as siblings and our dad, who we knew he was getting overwhelmed just being with her 24/7 because of the pandemic and just trying to keep her safe as well. But I think we did a great job of adapting and like FaceTime, Zoom, even being outdoors and going for like a family walk as much as possible. We just had to adapt. And I will say one positive of someone with Alzheimer's is they're not aware of what's going on. So it's just really nice that she's always happy.
I wanted to switch gears a little bit here and ask about some of the highlights that you've had throughout your experiences with the programs at the Mesulam Center.
We went to the support group starting, I believe, September of 2017. Hearing about other people's stories and experiences was extremely helpful for us as a family because it was so new. It was relatively new to us at the time, and she wasn't, you know, as far into the decline as she is now. So we got a little idea of what might happen in the future, and also just, you know, form those relationships with people who are going through the same thing.
What advice would you guys give to other adult children of a parent who's been diagnosed with young onset Alzheimer's disease during this time?
One piece of advice is just to make sure that you're always laughing and take things lightheartedly. My brother is the ultimate jokester, prankster, and he loves like poking fun at my mom and tickling her, picking her up and carrying her, as you can see in this video.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. And is there anything else that you guys would want to share with others who are living just with Alzheimer's disease and their families?
We can't do it by ourselves. It's okay to ask for help, and it's probably a lot better and as smooth a ride as possible if you do ask for help. We were fortunate enough to have things set up with the center and through Northwestern, and they were just so accommodating, and it made us feel like we were well taken care of and our mom was in the right hands. And I really appreciate what the center has done for my mom and just for us and for our mental health in general. And I think that anyone dealing with Alzheimer's, even outside the pandemic, it's just seek out that help, seek out that support.
If you guys could both just go ahead and introduce yourselves.
My name is Rick. And?
I'm Beverly. We live in Payson, Arizona. Mm-hmm. And we've been married
42 years.
Good for you.
Or so.
42 years. Fantastic. And can you tell us about how you both heard about PPA?
You noticed that your cognitive abilities of reading and writing and your math and your spelling were declining. And we didn't understand why. So we decided to start looking around, and it was 3 years before Rick got his diagnosis. And when they said PPA, we both went,
I have no idea.
What's that mean?
How have you guys dealt with challenges, you know, over this last year, both individually and as a couple?
We have the opportunity to step outside.
We isolated.
We just waited for, you know, getting that those shots so that we could feel a little more careful about what we were doing. And
but we kept active. Yeah. We
wonderful.
We played Rummy Cube. We walked our dog. We did some in the house projects. We did some outside projects. We're both bird watchers, so we were busy all the time. And actually, I think we both kind of took a deep breath and said, this isn't so bad.
You've been participating in our research here at the Mesulam Center. Can you tell me a little bit more about some of the highlights of that research participation and what your experience has been like by being a research participant at the Mesulam Center?
A friend of ours, Brian, had seen a video or TV program on the possibilities that were being developed there at Mesulam Center. And he suggested, since he knew that we had PPA, he suggested that we look into it, which we did, and came up with being involved in Communication Bridge.
Yeah. It was the first thing we did when we got back home. It's like, okay, where do we find this? You know, that, even though I've been out of there now for a year, I guess.
Maybe two.
And
maybe one.
And, you know, every week, I go, you know, I still do the projects. It's working for me. You know, all the, I see a tree that I learned, you know.
Relearned.
Yeah, relearned through this. You know, it comes back and it makes me happy every time when I can do that. So.
And actually, Rick said once a week, he's probably 5 or 6 days a week that he does this. Does his 30s.
it's my go-to. I just, if I just don't know how, know what I want to do, or I, you know, I just go into the
office
and sit down. And when I come up, I feel better and like, okay, I can do something.
What advice would you guys give to someone who was in your situation, who's recently been diagnosed with PPA?
Well, I would hope that they could get the same that I had, opportunity that I
to had. Be with a Communication Bridge group.
Yeah,
we're constantly busy. We are engaged. We ask questions. We are looking all the time for, you know, little hints that make a difference. Through the Communication Bridge program, Rick learned a lot of workarounds, different strategies to come up with the word that he's trying to come up with, which maybe was take a deep breath, walk away, pause, you know, those kinds of things. He uses his phone a lot to look things up. So different resources. And I still use the Communication Bridge. Actually, it's not Communication Bridge, the PPA support group for care partners. And that's been awesome. We also get newsletters.
A lot of times I just need to go outside. And the beauty of that is I don't notice that I'm that I have this issue. And so I'm outside. Nobody's talking to me, or you know, I'm looking at the birds, and they don't know what I have. And so it's just nice to be out there, and feeling what you know I used to have. It's been, I would say, difficult for Bev much more on you know the daily thing. She had to learn all the things that I had done with taxes and all that kind of stuff. She's you know just picked it all up. And,
I think we both focus on what we can do, as opposed to thinking the other way around.
Yeah.
So working with the half full glass kind of thing. The main thing I think you want to do is stay engaged, because you want to stay on the plateau that you're at. You don't want to lose. And being engaged seems to be, it's work, but it's a good thing.
You know, I've picked up a lot of other projects. You know, the wiping, the vacuum cleaner, all kinds of things that that helps her
big time,
so that she can do stuff for me.
Is there anything else that you guys would want to share to anybody else who might be watching, who's living with PPA or might have it in their families?
I'd say don't give up. You know, today's your day. Most of the time, I don't really feel like I'm having, you know, this issue, because I'm doing other things and things, you know, that I can do. And so just stick with it, and who knows what's going to happen.
I can't add to that.
Good afternoon. I am Darby Moorhart, and I will be moderating today's Quality of Life Symposium. This symposium is sponsored by the Glenn and Wendy Miller Family Foundation. Glenn and Wendy Miller and their daughter Lauren Isaacs have been good friends of mine and the center for many years. This symposium features an opportunity for all of you to ask your questions of our distinguished panel. I expect that we will not get to all of your questions, but please know that we will do our best. Our panel includes Dr. Emily Rogalski, who gave today's outstanding Mendelsohn lecture. The families from whom you just heard, Russell and Barbara Zage, the Reyes family, Chris, Candace, and Celine, and Rick and Bev Malmberg. We are grateful for the stories you shared with us today and for being here. I would also like to introduce two of our clinicians. Social worker Debbie Dislin counsels persons living with dementia and their families in our Northwestern Medicine Neurobehavior and Memory Clinic. And she also directs our Support and Education for Early Dementia, or SEED program, which is an 8-week class for newly diagnosed persons living with dementia and their families. And then Dr. Ian Grant. Dr. Grant is Assistant Professor of Neurology and a Behavioral Neurologist with the Mesulam Center. Dr. Grant provides diagnostic evaluations, ongoing treatment and care to countless patients and families in our neurobehavior and memory clinic. Dr. Grant is also the director of clinical trials operations for the Mesulam Center. So now let's get into some of the questions that that I'm seeing in the question and answer. And please do not hesitate to put in your questions. So the first question I would like to ask to Candace, Celine, and Chris, did you receive different diagnoses over time and as the disease progressed? And what were some of the resources that helped you understand the progression of Alzheimer's disease?
Sure, yes. I think the first diagnosis that we got or received was early cognitive decline. And then I guess probably because that's the most generalized term. And then we were asked to do more testing. I think as we started to get more information and go through more testing, we you know, they said it was probably dementia, but we never really got a formal diagnosis of Alzheimer's, but that's what we suspect it is.
That diagnosis journey can be somewhat complicated and uncertain along the way. A question, we've had a few questions regarding medications. I'm thinking that Dr. Grant, if you could please comment on, one of the questions was on a drug called IPW. Maybe we'll start with that one.
I'll admit that I hadn't been familiar with that particular drug, so I did a little bit of digging when I saw the question. It appears to be a drug that's been tested in mice models so far for Alzheimer's disease, targeting some of the inflammatory aspects of Alzheimer's disease. It doesn't appear that it's moved beyond any mice models yet.
Okay. And then I'm going to stick with you, Dr. Grant, because there's a couple other questions. One is about the new drug, donanemab. Mm-hmm. And then also, is Prevagen at all effective in improving memory? So if you could address those.
Sure. So to address the question regarding donanemab, as probably many people who pay attention to these sorts of things are aware, donanemab is a drug manufactured by Eli Lilly, and it's in a class of medications that's been tested over the past decade or so, and works by removing different forms of amyloid from the brain. So, amyloid is considered to be the first real pathological change that occurs in the brain in Alzheimer's disease that presumably leads to some of these downstream changes in the brain. So the thinking is that if you can remove one of these pathological elements, that can result in some either improvement or potentially slowing of decline. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of failures in this regard. So over the years, for various reasons, it's been found that removing amyloid from the brain alone doesn't necessarily seem to cause that much of a difference in the clinical picture over time. However, a lot of these early studies also were not probably as careful in their selection of the patients they were testing these drugs in. So as Dr. Rogalski had mentioned earlier, if you don't know for a fact that a person actually has Alzheimer's disease, meaning the actual pathology in their brain, then giving them a drug that treats that underlying disease, it wouldn't be expected to have any sort of benefit. So now with more recent trials, there's better selection for patients because we have better biomarkers to know for a fact that there's elevated amyloid in a person's brain. So donanemab is something that's currently moving forward in a phase 3 trial. So generally speaking, for a medication to be approved for use by the FDA, it needs to have two large phase 3 studies done that show its efficacy. And some earlier, somewhat smaller phase 2 studies released some data in the past few months that showed that there did seem to be some promising effect from that drug. So by administering the drug and removing amyloid in the brains of people with mild disease, mild in terms of their symptoms, meaning they're still kind of at an early stage, they showed significantly less decline compared to people who received placebo over the course of about a year and a half. And again, it's important to note this isn't a cure by any means. It's something that slowed down the progression. So people still got worse. They just got worse noticeably slower. I can connect that to another drug that some people may have heard about in news recently. A company called Biogen makes a drug called aducanumab, which is something that acts in a similar way. And it had completed partially a couple of phase 3 clinical trials a couple of years ago, but there was a feeling that perhaps it did show enough of a benefit to possibly warrant approval. So the FDA is still currently considering that, and probably there will be a decision sometime within the next month or so. So Then to come back to the other question, Darby, that was mentioned regarding some other things that are out there, non-prescription drugs. So Prevagen is something that gets marketed a lot in terms of something that can, you know, slow down memory loss or preserve your memory. And unfortunately, you know, these are things that there just really isn't a lot of data to back up the claims that they put out. There was a larger meta-analysis of what studies do exist like about a year or so ago of things like Prevagen and other similar kind of over-the-counter memory enhancers. And there really just wasn't found to be much of a benefit, at least not people who already had cognitive impairment. Most of these probably are still things that are generally safe. So I usually won't tell my patients that they really shouldn't go out and get them, but I don't go out of my way to recommend them. Now that being said, there's something else worth noting is that there was another study last year that found that some over-the-counter quote unquote memory enhancers actually contained pharmaceutical agents that were not even approved in the United States and were approved in other countries and were present in those drugs at even higher doses than what were than they were approved for in the countries where they were approved. So even some of the safety aspects might come into question for some of these things. So my advice to anyone considering that would be to consult with your doctor before just going out and loading up on all the memory supplements you can find.
Great. Thank you for clarifying that, Dr. Grant. I want to turn to Dr. Rogalski. We've had a few questions regarding the definition of both progressive primary progressive aphasia and frontotemporal degeneration. If you could just expound on that a bit more.
Sure, I'd be glad to. So there are, when we think about the general term dementia, it's a general term for the loss of memory or other thinking skills. And that change is so severe that it's starting to impact your daily life. And what we've learned over time is that there can be different dementia syndromes, some that target the memory areas of the brain, and we most commonly call that Alzheimer's dementia, and then some diseases that target specifically the language parts of the brain. And when that happens, we call that primary progressive aphasia. And the name comes from aphasia, referring to the language loss, and then primary because language is the one part that's the one cognitive function that's affected. And while other thinking abilities, such as memory and attention, are spared, and progressive because it will get worse with time. And then frontotemporal dementia is a term that's used to describe another dementia syndrome, especially when you put the words behavioral variant, frontotemporal dementia, in front of it. And it describes a dementia syndrome where instead of the neurodegenerative diseases attacking the language network or the memory network, it's attacking the areas of the brain that are responsible for behavior and judgment and personality. And that's where that describes that syndrome.
Okay, thank you. And I know that both, all of our families didn't have I know your interviews were cut short due to time constraints for today, but I was wondering if Russ and Barbara, you could talk, and also Rick and Beverly and Candace, Celine and Chris, if you could just talk about some of the ways that you're living with this illness and the ways that you are staying as living the quality of life, the best quality of life you can with this. So Russ and Barb, do you want to give that a start?
Sure. It's with FTD, it's very difficult because personality and behavior is often subjective. So it makes it difficult for us sometimes. And the fact that Russ doesn't recognize a lot of it. So I'm seeing it, he's not seeing it. And I'm seeing the changes in him. And with FTD, there's no pattern. There's not a progression that we know of, and everyone is different. So, you know, oftentimes we're not sure if this is part of FTD or is it something else. I think we're both getting used to the fact that it's mostly, this is FTD. But it's hard often to deal with what one can't understand. And so for Russ, he doesn't understand that, you know, what he did or what he said was not appropriate, or his judgment is skewed. He doesn't see any of that. So we're trying to adjust our lives so that we can cohabitate easily.
Yeah.
You know, living with someone very different.
Yeah. Yeah, it can really be a struggle because your relationship changes. And totally. Russ, would you like to respond to that?
Well, I think Barb is right. You know, so many things that you will talk about, I don't necessarily see. And so it takes some introspection on my part to be able to understand what she's talking about. And sometimes that's difficult as it is, because there's a part of you that's always in denial. That says, no, that's not happening. And you know, in reality, it really is. And so I think that's probably the most difficult part for me, is recognizing that, yeah, there is something there.
Thank you both. Rick and Beverly, would you like to respond to that? What keeps you living your best quality of life?
We have come up with a way to make a team out of it, that we, everything's kind of been flipped over. All the things I did, you know, aren't there. I can't, you know, speak certain things. So we just try to blend it all together, and you know, I end up with, you know, in the house, you know, I, what do we do? Let's say.
You vacuum.
The vacuum, yes. You know, fix things. I go outside and do things while Bev is kind of stuck with a lot of the things I used to do, which involved
the finances,
and she's had to learn all of that, probably better than any I did, but so yeah, we kind of blend together a lot, with being the our top person.
I think that we try and keep humor in our life, find things to laugh about, and, you know, just because we have this diagnosis, it's not our whole life. It's a part of our life. So we are very involved in other things and take every day, one day at a time, and make it the best.
Written message.
And I like to go outside a lot, and we, as we said, that we, a lot of birds are in our minds, and so you know, I can spend an all day out there and not even know that I didn't do something, you know what I mean?
Right.
That I didn't have to try to find something. It's, you know, when I'm outside, you know, it's all, everything's, you know, good for me. So,
Nice. Great messages. Thank you. Candace and Celine and Chris, your thoughts on, further thoughts on living with this illness with your mom.
For us, we try to adapt as much as possible. And it's a, really a trial and error kind of thing, but we've figured out things that really make our mom happy when we're with her. So we really latch onto those things. For example, she really loved music. She really loves kids, being a pediatrician. So we play music all the time. She sings along, we sing along with her. And when she's with my sister's son, she thinks the world of him. She's so happy. And she really latches onto like her maternal role before she was diagnosed. So we really try just to make our mom happy. We stopped correcting her, we just let things slide and we just go along with it. It's just really go with the flow kind of thing. And when we are together, it is a team effort, like the previous families have mentioned. So yeah, it's just really nice to try and make our mom happy with like music and just even reminiscing with old memories. She loves that, like telling stories. And she'll still remember like things like, oh, Celine was like a little chubby kid, or, you know, it's, or Chris was such a good sleeper. And she'll just go on and on. And you just try to talk to her like she's living those days again. And she seems to be very happy when we do that.
So thank you for sharing that. So you enter her where she is currently and enter her reality and enjoy that with her. So thank you for that. Debbie, I want to turn to you because we have some questions here about how to access care and support. There's some questions around how do you get into the caregiver support groups at the Mesulam Center? And then also there are some people that are grappling with how to get care in the home as well. Could you address those questions?
Sure. Thanks, Debbie. So the Mesulam Center offers many different support programs. And when the pandemic first hit, we transitioned those from in-person programs to online. And one of the beneficial aspects of that has meant that people are able to join from across the US or across the world even. So right now you can contact us, go online to our website and look at the care and support tab to learn more about the programs. We have 3 monthly support groups for care partners or family members of people with first PPA. The second monthly care partner support group is for family members of those with a younger onset dementia. And this can be regardless of the specific diagnosis, and it's affecting someone under 65 or who was diagnosed or had symptoms when they were under 65. And the third is for care partners with FTD, or care partners of people with FTD. We also have the SEED program, which stands for Support and Education for Early Dementia, which is an 8-week program, which we offer periodically and currently offer online. For many of our families, they might have seen a primary care doctor. That primary care doctor may have given them a referral to a neurologist or a psychologist or a psychiatrist to try to understand what was happening in their life. That's often the first step of connecting to additional care. Then our families may have seen a neurologist, and maybe that neurologist diagnosed them with mild cognitive impairment or any type of dementia. Then the SEED program works with them to establish some next steps in terms of understanding, as some of our family panelists have spoken to. You want to understand what's happening and also what you can do about it and to connect to other people who are living similar experiences with the symptoms and diagnoses. There are a number of organizations in the community that provide in-home care. They also provide adult day programs. So these are group-based opportunities for social engagement, for artistic expression, for sometimes physical activity as well. So you can always reach out to us with questions about where to find care, like through our neurobehavior and memory clinic. And it can be a lot to navigate. So feel free to ask further questions of your care providers and of us.
Thank you,
Debbie. Feel free to add anything, Darby.
Thank you, Debbie. That's great. Dr. Grant, we have a couple questions here that are symptom related. And so I'm directing them to you, but I can certainly open it up to everyone on this panel. But are there personality changes with Alzheimer's disease is one question.
Yeah, that's a good question. So, you know, people commonly think of frontotemporal dementias as having these big personality changes and just behaviors that are very much out of character. But we do see similar types of changes in people with Alzheimer's disease as well. There are even some that kind of have what some researchers call a frontal variant of Alzheimer's disease, where their early symptoms are personality changes. But even in people with pretty typical initial symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, you know, short-term memory loss, those kinds of things, it's not unusual that there can be some behavioral or personality changes. Common things tend to be increased frustration, increased irritability, which in a lot of ways is entirely understandable. You know, people are getting used to being a way that they are not used to being, and reconciling the idea of who one has been throughout their entire life with who one is now is not an easy process, and that can lead to irritability, frustration with those around them, with themselves. So there can be kind of shorter tempers, more tendency to kind of snap at people, and that's a fairly common early symptom, I would say. Now, more significant behavioral issues can also occur as time goes on. And what I oftentimes tell people is that, while we certainly sometimes see cases where a person was always a very pleasant and easygoing individual, and then as the disease kind of advanced, there was a lot more agitation and some inappropriate behaviors, some aggression, that sort of thing. Typically, the more common thing that we usually see is that the way a person was during the course of their life kind of just gets amplified as they get further along into the disease. So, if a person was always a very pleasant and kind of go with the flow type of person, you'll oftentimes see that just kind of tends to be more the case. They just kind of say okay to suggestions and kind of go along with recommendations, versus people who have always been very strongly, fiercely independent throughout the course of their lives. That tends to take center stage a lot of times with the progression of the disease, because people again have a very strong idea of who they've been, what they can and can't do. And when the disease starts to affect that, the person is not always aware of those limitations and become very defensive. There can be a resistance to lots of suggestions and recommendations that family members and those trying to help are really just doing out of a desire to provide for the person to make sure they have what they need. And those are the situations that tend to be the most difficult, trying to help a person who doesn't seem to want to be helped. But, and it can be a thing that can be, people can feel like it's being taken personally, that they're really being, attacked and not appreciated for the things they're trying to do. But it's always also important to take a step back to recognize that it's an effect of the disease, and, the person is still themselves. There are just certain behaviors that have changed as a result. And we try to do what we can to work around those issues. And like Darby said before, there are lots of ways we can enter a person's own reality to make a lot of these interactions a bit more smooth and encounter a bit less resistance.
The other question is on, can a person with early onset Alzheimer's present with aphasia? So
Yeah, no, that's a very good
related question. Yeah.
Yeah. And Dr. Rogalski kind of mentioned a little bit of this during her talk, but you know, people with what we think of as early onset Alzheimer's disease, defined by developing symptoms younger than age 65, that group of people, there's a higher tendency to develop some of these atypical syndromes. So whereas older individuals, as they develop Alzheimer's disease, the vast majority of the time, the early symptoms are really just that short-term memory loss. In younger individuals, people can develop different symptoms. And the reason for this is that the symptoms a person has depends entirely upon what areas of the brain are being involved and being affected by the underlying disease pathology. And so in some individuals, you know, the early area that gets affected is the language center. And so they develop a form of primary progressive aphasia as their early symptoms. There are also other forms that we see more commonly in younger individuals sometimes, but also in older individuals where the visual center of the brain is affected early on. And so their early symptoms may not be language, it may not be memory, it may actually be their ability to perceive things correctly in the environment around them. And again, these are just things that tend to be more common in these younger onset individuals.
This is really getting to that heterogeneity of dementia. That's the theme of today's and the theme of our center. Dr. Rogalski, this is a question on the genetics of superagers. We know that Alzheimer's disease has a strong genetic component. However, you did not observe much evidence for a genetic contribution in the superager group. Why do you think that is? Do you think we need a larger number of superagers to detect a genetic effect, or does genetics not play much of a role in the superagers?
Sure, I'd be glad to address that. I also just wanted to add just one more thing on top of what Ian was saying, is that we use these labels to describe different dementia syndromes, but at the end of the day, we are all human, and these diseases don't follow rules all of the time. So there's no rule that it says that the disease will just go to the language network first. And so there can, it gets messy. And so there's this possibility that your individual lived experience you don't fit neatly into one of these different boxes. And so this is work that Dr. Morehart, you know so well, that it's really thinking about where are the challenges and where are the strengths that are remaining, and then figuring out how we address those strengths and also challenges at the same time. And so celebrating what is still remaining and learning to navigate those challenges. So I don't want people to be dismayed if they didn't feel like they fit neatly into one of the labels or boxes that were up there. Okay, so I'll transition to super aging. So we haven't done, we're in the infancy of doing genetic work when it comes to super agers. Most genetic studies, geneticists won't even talk to you until you have hundreds of thousands of people to look at the genetic factors that are involved. What we did here is we borrowed an existing tool called a polygenic hazard score that had been developed. And so in this particular tool, we saw that superagers didn't differ than cognitively average 80 plus year olds, but it doesn't by no means it does not mean that there are not important genetic components to the superaging phenotype. But the point we were trying to make is they don't seem to just be the opposite of Alzheimer's disease from a genetic standpoint.
Thank you, Dr. Rogalski. Debbie, I have a question here that this person's mother is displaying signs of dementia and will not even allow a discussion of doctors. What are some strategies to get her to address her memory loss with a doctor?
Yeah, there can be understandable trepidation about going and seeing a doctor for memory loss. There can be stigma with that. So you can certainly use your relationship to provide a context for concern. and also a context for support. You can talk with her about why you might want to go see a doctor, or you might want to get support as well. There are also a number of different opportunities for people who have memory loss or who are wondering about this to receive support and information. Sometimes we have people come to our clinic where they may have met someone through their network who had a similar experience. And so they felt encouraged that they weren't alone. And so some of the stigma was reduced. I also will just reflect on the process that Rick and Beverly, Russ and Barbara and Celine, Candace and Chris shared earlier, that it can be a rough process. And you really want to focus on the person who's experiencing these challenges, to recognize the emotional weight of what might be happening to them, and to recognize what is happening within your relationship and your family. So there's no one size fits all approach. There may be some trial and error, but those are just some reflections on what some families have found helpful to make seeking information and seeking support more palatable.
And then there's a question directed to both Russ and Rick. Do you have any new hobbies or interests?
Well, for me, I've actually begun doing some craft projects that I had never really done before. And it's relaxing. It's kind of fun to do them. It's a learning thing, trying something new that you've not really played with before. And so far, and whether they're lying to me or not, but people tell me that they like them. So,
would you mind sharing with us what you're doing?
Well, I've been making some Christmas trees that light up, and doing a lot of things with epoxy. I put together a Cubs table and epoxied some of that on the top of it, and have done some of those kinds of things. I was working on, I did some things for my granddaughters that I made a couple of things for them, some necklaces, and made a plaque for Barb that had some angels on it. And so just a few different things. You know, I've never been an artistic person. Drawing a stick figure was difficult. It never looked like a person. And so here I am doing some of these things, and it's fun and it's different and it's relaxing. So it keeps my mind off of things.
Ah, thank you for sharing that. And then Rick, what about you?
Well, not the same. I do a lot of the same things that I did when I was younger, but what else? One of the things is that I was I did a lot of writing and mathematics. And with that gone, I feel sort of like I'm out in a way, you know, a large area, and you know, it gives me some, I think, some ways of I don't know. What do you think?
I think he's had to relearn some of the hobbies that he was very involved in. But pretty much he has stuck with and been fortunate and able to do a lot of his exercising, taking our dog out for a walk, surprisingly still playing Rummy Cube, which is kind of about math. It's just like, kind of makes no sense. He used to be, his nickname was the wordsmith. All of us used to go to him for, we're looking for the right word, whatever it is. That's not there anymore. That's okay. You know, we just move past
that. I'm asking them back, so. it's working for us. So it's
thank you.
You know, we're traveling.
Oh, I'm sorry.
One of the things he does do quite a bit is we have an elderly neighbor, and he always checks on her and takes her garbage in and newspaper and those kinds of things. So
trying to help people.
Yeah, absolutely. We have a couple minutes left. I do have a couple more questions here. I wanted to ask the Reyes family, you mentioned music and with your mom, and I just wanted you to, music's so powerful. It's powerful whether you have dementia or not, but I wonder how you're using that. If you could just speak a little bit more about music in your mom's life and in your life as a family.
Sure. So we actually all played instruments growing up, piano and violin. And over since her diagnosis, there have been times where I just take out my violin and start playing for her, and she's just like lights up. Like, I have her attention. She's happy. I've pulled it out in times where I feel like she's getting kind of like irritated or paranoid, and her mood is immediately improved. And then, like my sister said, in the video, I think we play music when she's around. She's always humming something, and we'll just hum whatever she's humming to, even though we don't recognize the song all the time. But it's like amazing how she remembers Christmas songs, songs that she listened to in her younger years that we don't even know about. Whenever the radio's playing, she'll recognize and sing along. But yeah, I mean, music has been a big part of our family forever. And so we really use that to our advantage to keep her happy and not make her feel like anything's wrong. Oh, and she also did participate in those, what are they called? The Memory Cafe.
Oh yeah, when there was music.
Before COVID, and did those like activities with musical instruments, and she really liked those too. My sister took her to those, so.
Great. Well, this really speaks to the non-pharmacological or non-drug therapies that really are quite abundant, that we just need to focus on and find to help, how we live with this, how you all live with this illness. And while the drug studies are very important, and we're trying to learn as much as we can to get better treatments, until we do have better treatments for Alzheimer's, PPA, FTD, we do need to rely on these non-pharmacological interventions. So thank you for sharing that. And I think we're at the end of our time, and I want to thank everyone who submitted questions and to our panelists for this wonderful discussion. This concludes our Quality of Life Symposium, sponsored by Glenn and Wendy Miller Family Foundation. And I'm now going to turn it over to Lisa to provide some important closing information. Again, thank you to all of you for being here today.
Thank you, Darby. And thank you to all of our attendees for attending the Northwestern Mesulam Center's 27th Annual Alzheimer Day. Again, I want to say a huge thank you to all our families who were panelists during today's event, and for sharing their stories with our audience. Rick and Bev, Russ and Barb, Celine, Candace, and Chris, on behalf of everyone at the Mesulam Center, we appreciate all of you for sharing your stories today and answering questions from our audience. Thank you to the Mendelson family and to the Glenn and Wendy Miller Family Foundation for their generous support of this event.